Time having arrived, we call this meeting of the Brockton School Committee to order. Ask you to please rise and join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Well, good evening. Great to have you all here with us. We normally open the meeting with hearing of visitors. That's an opportunity for members of the public to address the school committee, the superintendent, and myself on any matter that they would like to address with us. You need to sign up before the meeting starts, and tonight we did not have anyone sign up, so we'll get right into tonight's agenda. We'll start off with the consent agenda. Consent agenda is a block of routine business in front of the school committee that we treat in its entirety in order to keep the meeting moving along. However, any individual member of the school committee may request that any item on the consent agenda be removed for individual consideration and discussion. So at this time, I'll just poll the committee to see if any members would like any of the items removed from the consent agenda. If not, then I'll entertain a motion. Motion's been made and properly seconded. All in favor in approving the consent agenda? Consent agenda is approved. So we'll then, Superintendent, we'll move right on to the Superintendent of Schools report on teaching and learning. Right.
And I know, Mayor, we have the holiday season upon us and we're going to try to do this in light speed, but I do want to bring to your attention there's a trophy sitting in front of us here. You did hear me talk about the trivia contest. I was recently sent truly the official trophy, and I'll talk about it at the end of the meeting. I'd like to talk a little longer about it. I'm excited this evening to talk about, you know, two of our students and anyone that had the opportunity last week. And Mr. Minicello, I know you went twice to see the holiday concert at Brockton High School. It was just fabulous. You close your eyes. You think you're in Symphony Hall listening to the chorus and certainly the band, the ensembles. It's just really tremendous. So I want to thank everybody that took part in that. And two young ladies that we'll recognize right now are very much a part of our music program at Brockton High School. Mr. Mayor, do you want to read?
Sure. So we're going to bring the two students down in just a moment so that the superintendent and I and the school committee as a whole can recognize them, but let me just share with everybody the letter of recognition that we'll be presenting to each of these outstanding young ladies. On behalf of the entire school committee, congratulations for being selected to perform with the 2017 American Choral Directors Association National Honor Choir. This prestigious honor, which went to only 300 students nationwide, will be an experience that you will never forget. Brockton High School is certainly very proud of you, and we know you will represent our city of champions like a true champion. And these letters of recognition are co-signed by the superintendent and myself. And so we'd like to invite Michelle Garza and Corina Katsiopoulos to come down and please join us.
I think we should invite down Matthew Cunningham.
Yeah, let's get Mr. Cunningham director down here too.
Matt, do you want to talk about this award? We're so proud of these two young women.
Yep, come on in here. Hi, how are you?
This is Corina. Congratulations. And Michelle, congratulations.
So thank you everyone for having us this evening. We really appreciate it, especially coming off of the concerts last week. So the American Choral Directors Association is an organization to which choral directors from kindergarten basically all the way through college belong, and I'm a member of it, and every other year they have a national conference and then a divisional conference. So we're part of the Eastern Division. So last year we had the Eastern Division conference at which Michelle performed with the honor choir there, but this year is a national conference and it's in Minneapolis, Minnesota. So these girls submitted an audition. It was a blind audition, meaning they had to record their part to a piece by Mozart, actually. And what they did was they submitted it, and there's a panel of judges who listen to all these recordings from across the country, and they select the best out of them. So there were over 4,000 applicants to this this honor choir, and only 300 were chosen. And these girls will be 2 out of 80 sopranos. So really, it's really, really select. So we're certainly very proud of them, and we know they'll represent us very well in March at the conference.
Thank you very much, Mr.
Thank
Cunningham.
You.
And we'd like to get a nice picture
and
get you up on the web. How does that sound? Mr. Cunningham, will you join us?
Yeah, come on, Matt. Get up here.
Right in there? We do.
Do this way, okay.
Thank you very much. Congratulations,
girls.
I do want to do my charter school update. As of today, the enrollment of the charter school of our Brockton Public School students that have left are 235 students are enrolled. I also want to bring to your attention that the charter has relocated to Brockton as of December 12th. We are providing 3 buses, and I want to finish up by sharing with you a letter that I submitted to the Commissioner of Education back in, I believe, October, November. And what I want to say, and I definitely want the public to hear me saying this, is there is a process that we go by, whether students leave Brockton to go to a school in Florida or go to any of our neighboring towns. The process is that you fill out a form to release your records. It's very legal. The records that we release are educational. They could be special education records. They're medical records. And it's something that we take very seriously. We shared with the charter at the time when they originally came to us with their list of students that were leaving, and it was, you know, a release of a number of records. We shared with them our process, our protocol. We shared documents. And to our dismay, what we found out late summer into early fall as we began school is that the signatures were not the parents' signatures on these forms. And in fact, they were signed by people at the charter school. Explanation was that they had made phone calls or texted parents. You know, that is just something that I think many of us know, that if you ever sign a name, you might initial it, you might do something if a parent was unable to be there. And it's not something that the Brockton Public Schools would ever employ as a practice. I brought it to the attention of the commissioner. They have corrected that practice. I want parents to know that in good faith, if you are taking your children out of any school, you know, please sign that release of records so that we can all make sure that our children's records are protected. Again, I will continue to work with the Department of Education in the best interest of all of our students, but I certainly won't compromise the protocols and the procedures that we have put in place. And we're also very willing to work with other schools if the children are coming or going. So I just want that to be part of my update, and I'll continue to update you as we go forward. Also, you heard me talk at a previous meeting about an MCAS waiver update, and I am going to ask Dr. Cancel to join me up here at this time. We had had a protocol of cohort groups, and because we're unable to do one-to-one devices across the district at this time, we had, with a lot of thought, involving a lot of people in the district, from the technology department to teaching and learning, talking about, if you originally go back to the beginning when we were a pilot program, we brought on the first year, not that we had a choice, with online testing. It was the Raymond, I believe, and the Hancock. That was the first year as a pilot year. We then asked schools that wanted to come on board. The Ashfield came on board. The Huntington had a large number of devices. The Downey, I believe, was another. This year, we've added South and the Davis. So we had a plan in place, and what happened all over the Commonwealth in the summer was a conversation about this MCAS Next Generation testing and wanting to test all 8th graders and 4th graders with online testing, computer-based testing, the CBT, versus the paper-based testing. And many districts don't have the capability to have computers with all of their students for testing. We put in a waiver. We went back and forth with the department. At this point here, we're deploying a large number of devices, And it was our model was not going to be able to be followed when the department and I had a conversation about the present eighth graders needing to take the computer-based testing, because the next, when they are 10th graders, and that is their competency determination, they will be taking that online. And we want to at least give every one of our eighth graders an opportunity to make sure that they had a sampling of what the online testing resulted in. So I'll ask Dr. Cancel to really just talk about the district at this point, and I didn't bring up the fourth graders. I'd like you to share that.
Okay, good evening. There's really not more to add to that. I think the superintendent laid it out pretty well and fully. The state wanted all fourth and eighth graders to take the next generation, and they wanted to do that to ensure that they had a representative sample of students, because it's a brand new test. They have to figure the test out. In Brockton, we have a history, actually, of instead of having each, you know, school have one class or a couple classes here or there, we tended to concentrate all of our resources, so an entire school. So the first year, we were going to have, I think, 22 different groups of kids take tests in all the different schools. And instead, what we ended up doing was we concentrated it in the Raymond and the Hancock School, as the superintendent pointed out. So what we did, we asked for a waiver for the fourth grade. And in exchange, and the state granted that waiver, in exchange we said we had five schools that already did PARC. And that's, we believe, going to be similar to the next generation MCAS. We've added to the elementary schools. So we're now going to have Downey, Davis is going to be, we call it an elementary, but it's a K-3. It's going to be all grades, 3 through 8 at Davis. We have Hancock, who by this time is an old hand at the online test. Huntington, same thing. Angelo will be new, George will be new, and the Raymond, another one of our originals. In addition, we have Ashfield and South Middle. And so that's going to be the elementary now, as the superintendent said, with the middle schools. We mentioned that Ashfield, who's done it before, all the students are going to do it. South, all the students are going to do it. And every other middle school will have eighth grade. And the reason for that is when those students get to 10th grade, they're going to have to take an online test for the graduation requirement. And the superintendent felt, and I strongly supported this one, you can't ask a child to take a high-stakes test in a brand new medium for the first time. So in eighth grade, they will have taken the online test. So when they come to 10th grade, it will not be their first time under real-life test conditions taking an online test. So that's the rationale behind it. It wasn't perfect. It's not exactly what we'd want, but it's easier if you have one-to-one for everybody, but we're not there yet. And so that's why we proposed this to the state. The state approved of our rationale, and they granted the waiver. 10th grade, just so everyone is clear, that's MCAS. That's the old traditional MCAS. So that's a different, and that's all paper. And this year it's weird because they actually have a different set of rules and accommodations. So it's, you really have 3 through 8, and then 10th grade is separate.
Any questions for Dr. Cancel?
Okay, Dr. Cancel, while I get in here, I want to bring up, and I had Dr. Cancel put together attendance charts for Friday. So first of all, you know, here we are in December. Not that it's unusual. We live in New England, and you saw as well as I did, you know, the predictions as we were going through the week. And I want to talk about this because obviously the New England weather is here, and we're going to be dealing with this for the next couple of months. I'm very pleased, Mayor, over the past couple of years, and I've said this a number of times, you know, what we have in place here with our DPW, the communications with BEMA, the Brockton Emergency Management System, Steve Hook, Larry Rowley, yourself kind of leading us during, you know, storms, or, you know, it's not just one person having to deal with some of the decisions that we make. We take into account so many things. This becomes tough when you're talking about very cold weather, below zero temperatures. and wanting to make sure, and again, I've worked with Deputy Superintendent Thomas over this, and what we did was we prepared the principals to make sure people would be there early in the buildings if children were dropped off, because parents are going to work, sometimes to Boston or other places, and you know, really are counting on the kids. You know, probably some of these kids walk to school, and maybe parents would have the opportunity to drop them off. We also watched, and you saw a number of communities more on the North Shore doing the two-hour delays. We felt that there wasn't going to be much of a temperature change, and the way that we dealt with parents was you heard our Connect Ed message informing them of having the schools open, there would be no recess, asking them to work with us as partners, and it's so important as we get into this winter season for us to be able to work together so we can have schools on days that are safe for us to have school. One of the things Lisa Plant had asked for was the attendance, and we pulled the attendance. I had Dr. Cancel look back last year on the same date, look back at kind of an average, and there certainly were, you know, and I think the media is really tough on this. You know, when the media continually is blasting about the weather and if somebody is outside for so many minutes, you know, it becomes very concerning to, obviously we've got little children and some of them walk. Not every parent has transportation. I would ask parents out there to work with your neighbors, you know, work something out where if there is a parent able to drive so we don't have kids, you know, walking. I want to thank for a student and Deputy Superintendent Thomas. We had buses along the major routes picking up some of those kids who clearly are just walkers in the district and getting them to school. So I will have Dr. Cancel talk a little bit about the attendance, but the attendance was down throughout the district. It's still a call I would have made again. We were able to get a full day of school in. We didn't have any instances. I did get a couple of emails, you know, from parents sharing their concerns, and parents have to do certainly what's right for their children.
Okay, so I created these. There are three different ways to look at the attendance, or not there. There are many, many different ways, but I've given you three looks at the attendance. And the first one is simply sorted alphabetically. YTD is year to date. So that's the attendance percentage to date. So the Angelo has a 95.88% attendance from the first of the first day of school until it was actually Friday. That was last Friday's year to date. On last Friday, again, sticking with the Angelo, they had an 82.98% attendance. So there was clearly, you can see this gap, and I've calculated for every school the difference between what their year-to-date attendance was and their attendance on Friday. The second chart on the second, you know, the second page, this gives you a chance to look at how big is the gap, and it's very interesting to me that it's just intriguing. The gateway students, those are our students who are enrolled. It's a dual enrollment program where they're enrolled at Gateway. They're officially Brockton Public School children who attend Gateway to college at Massasoit. They actually had better attendance. So that was that. You see the others in terms of the gap. It ranges. FDA is the abbreviation for Frederick Douglass Academy. And they had a very small gap, and down to our most fragile children at the Gilmore, they had the largest gap between their regular attendance and Fridays. The third look is sorted by the actual attendance, because while the gap is something, it's also important just to know who had the best attendance and who did not. And you see that Gateway had a high rate of attendance. Something also about a program like Gateway, they're not that many students. So you can have very big movement with a relatively small amount of students. But you do see that a lot of our schools, Hancock West, Baker, Ashfield, they all kind of were in the same area. High 80s, which is lower than they usually run at this point. But I think what we don't know is the number of students who heard the call and didn't listen to it, or selectively were hoping to hear something, and they said, oh, there's a call, that means that there's no school. So we don't know that. We also don't know how many people said, you know, it's Friday, it's right before the holidays, the weather's bad. And then we also don't know how many were truly legitimate concerned because the weather hyped it up. So that is what the attendance was for this particular year. I did look at last year. I didn't include it. I can tell you right now, last year it was normal attendance in the mid-90s. You know, actually, you know, pretty much identical to what it the year to date was on that Friday. So the weather clearly played a role, and you know, that's the way it is. But I will say this, that I say this because I'm a guy who's worked in Brockton now for 11 years, and I still consider myself a newcomer to the system. And so when I think about having worked in a bunch of different school systems, the thing that distinguishes Brockton, and always has, is Brockton's willingness to work hard. And that's something that I hope Brockton never loses. So the people in the school work hard, you know, Mr. Cunningham's here late, you know, this just happens in Brockton. And when the weather is bad, I'm not talking about dangerous weather as in the kids are walking through the, you know, streets because they're 12-foot snowbanks. This is chilly weather, it's serious weather, but it's New England, that's winter. That is not a time where Brockton calls off school. It hasn't done it in the past. I think Brockton has to take care of its own. You have to make sure that when you see the kids dressed inappropriately, you say, look, put your jacket on, put your hat on. But this is something that I think was a very good call, and I hope that we can get more acclimated to winter and realize it will be cold. We live in New England. So if you have any questions about the data, I'm happy to answer.
A new concern was brought up to me that I didn't mention previously to this. We opened our schools early on this day, mm-hmm. but for our schools that have our Smart Start programs, we don't change the staffing at those schools when we do that. So we had many more students, but with the same amount of staffing at these schools. And that brings up a concern to me as well.
That's a good point, Lisa. We usually, when we have situations, we have worked with extended day to increase the staffing. I think what we did was we tried to open the schools, make sure the principal assistant, I think there were a couple of other people that were going to be there. But you're right, we usually, when we know it's snow a number of days, in other words, when we've had such large storms, but we're opening up, but it's still difficult, we'll overstaff with extended day. They've helped us out every time. I didn't do that this time.
Okay.
Was there a particular school that had many more students? We were trying to open up for those students that normally would be out and about. The parent might be heading off to, you know, work, and within a reasonable amount of time, they're out playing in the playground. And at that point, we don't want kids out there, you know, waiting for school to start. So we were getting them inside, get breakfast. I know Mike had the custodians there early to make sure, you know, the buildings were warm. We did have some trouble with some buildings. We had troubleshooting right away. A couple of buses went down for a student, had buses ready to take over. But you're right, I did not put extra staffing, but it is something we've done in the past.
Okay. So and perhaps we'd do it in the future,
yeah.
You said?
Yes, okay. Yeah. I don't know how many. I didn't hear from the principals that there was an overload, but I didn't ask either. Mm-hmm. I didn't ask how many additional kids came in, but we'll make note of that. You're right, we usually do make sure we have proper staff.
Thank you.
Anyone else with a question or comment? Ethan, thank you very much. Happy holidays.
And to move on to a wonderful program, the mayor, we had our weekly meeting, and we started the meeting with representatives from Sprint, because I think both of us were a little surprised. I knew we had applied for a grant, and then all of a sudden, the Sprint team put it on the wire service. The Enterprise picked it up, and in the paper, it started to talk about the devices that we received. So Mayor, do you want me to talk, or would you like to?
Well, you can outline essentially, I think it's about 13 school districts from across the entire country were selected by Sprint, and only two in New England, Providence and Brockton, so it's certainly a real achievement for us to be recognized and to be a school district that they want to work with, and the intent of this program is to help cities like Brockton bridge the digital divide, where we have so many kids that may be growing up in low-income households and may not have access to wireless internet or internet at all when they're home. And as time goes on, we know that a lot of homework lessons require internet access in order to complete them properly. And so, I mean, this is an issue that we face. It's an issue that we've already been working on as a school district. But Sprint is making a major national commitment, and they're piloting this program in, was it 11 or 13 cities?
I think it was 11.
11 cities across the country, and we're one of the cities selected. So it means that they're going to be providing, was it 500 of our students?
500 devices.
Yep. 500 of our students will be provided devices with wireless internet access for free from Sprint, with the idea that we're in the first group in the pilot, and then we will be eligible to apply for next September to even get a larger group of students. And it could easily be 1,500 or more if we're successful with the final grant application. So I think it's certainly very exciting for us. I think it fits with an overall strategy that the school district already has. It's going to help us get there faster in using Sprint's money, and really create some opportunities. So I'll let you take over,
right,
Superintendent.
Right. I want to thank Karen Watts and right away Dan Vigent and Bob Perkins, our associate principal at the high school, who got together, and this is something you had to apply for. They made that clear to the mayor and I, that I had asked why some of the larger districts didn't get it, and they said, well, you applied. So we took a chance. It was closing the homework gap, disadvantaged communities. The devices will be deployed in late January. I think what we're looking at Brockton High School is about 125 a house, and there will be kind of an application process. They're looking at who would best benefit. You could choose between a hotspot, a phone, or a tablet. So there is going to be a combination of the tablets and the phones that we'll be choosing for Brockton. And as the mayor said, I think this is for 5 years that we're given this anyway, but the opportunity to increase is right there. So they call it the $1 million, giving 1 million students access to a better future through Sprint. And there'll be more information to follow. They talk to us about when you have old devices, they'll have boxes around at different sites. And it's not that we're getting refurbished devices, but they take those and actually turn that somehow into money for this type of a program through, I believe, a foundation. So there's certainly more for us to look into here, but this was something we applied for. We were very fortunate, and we'll continue to update you as to the usage in the schools. I next want to do the NEASC two-year report update, and I'm going to ask Principal Wolder to come up. And if you recall, back in 2014 in October, we had our accreditation. We received our accreditation. One of the things that they do is there are different intervals when they ask you for an update on some of the things that they want you to remediate. I got a letter stating that we were on target. There was concerns about a couple of areas. We have 2 years. You can well imagine one of those is budget and making sure staffing. So I had asked Principal Wolder to come in January and probably spend a little more time going over not just the NEASC report, but talking about some updates as she did actually last August on Brockton High School. So I'm just going to have her just talk to the two-year update.
Ultimately, we had three areas that they asked us to provide an extended report. One of them was on the advisory, and they have an expectation that every student is tied to an adult at the school who is not their guidance counselor or their coach. And with the change in our schedule, the plan we originally had when we went through the initial self-study and the site visit, our change of schedule caused us to have a change of plans, which means we had to redo what we hoped to do with an advisory. So the restructuring committee and members of the school during a faculty meeting talked about how we can make that happen. Because we do have to address it, and we have 1 year to say, here's the plan and here's what we've implemented so far. So that's one area that we are working on. The second area that they wanted an additional report was on school-wide analytic rubrics. We have rubrics that we had in draft form at the time of the site visit. We've, as you know, have gone through several changes and other things going on at the school, and so our process of getting those in final draft form and getting them in, having the professional development that we needed for people to use them in a way that was meaningful. We haven't gotten to that yet. And so it's still a work in progress for us. So they would like an update on those analytic rubrics as well. And the final area was in budget. And every year I have to do a report of any changes that have happened in the school and give them information about impact. And so they want, beyond the report that we normally do, they want an additional 2-year report on that. So we'll talk about the schedule, how adding the electives is addressing some of the needs that we have, and some of the other things that we've put in place this year as a way to address some of the other areas of the budget. So we'll give them that information, and we have until January of next school year to provide them with that. The other areas that we had been making progress on with curriculum instruction and other areas of the school, they commended our work and said continue. We are still fully accredited. It was just those three areas they wanted additional information.
So I think the school committee certainly has made a commitment as we go into this budget season. We know that we're going to be very careful about our staffing. We have a schedule in place. And I know that's been your commitment to making sure the teachers are in the classroom, the class sizes are manageable, you know, for our teachers, and we'll continue to have this discussion, but I wanted you to just have that update. Any questions? Okay. Thanks. Thank you, Sharon. Okay, budget update. So what happens this time of year is we have what are called 9C cuts, and you know, you wait to see how the other shoe is going to drop. And I understand that this is the governor's prerogative or executive. I started to kind of look it up a little bit. So this is the governor taking a look at the budget, and you know, when you look at some of the hard work of our own legislative group, and then you see some of the cuts that they can just make across the board. It has nothing to do with how valuable the program is, the success of the program. I've been able, you know, in the past when I was director of community schools, to lobby for many of these funds. A lot of this happens to be after school funds, but some of our, and I do have Aldo Petronio back with us this week, if he wants to come up and we can just kind of go over. One of the ones that is concerning to us was our legislative delegation put $100,000 in for under McKinney-Vento because of the large numbers of homeless students and the transportation that was required. I can't say we were more than counting on that to allow us to bus all these children. Another one I'm concerned about is the Gateway to Cities ELL summer program, an excellent program. You know, really narrowing that achievement gap by giving extended learning time in the summer to many time newcomers. They go to school for just over, I think, 20 days. You know, excellent program, teachers developing curriculum taught by our own teaching staff. And I don't have the exact numbers on the amount of money, but that's seriously in jeopardy for this summer. An adult basic education grant, so we haven't seen exactly the particulars other than when you look at the $100,000, we can clearly tell that that was for our McKinney-Vento. And our after-school, out-of-school time program, which at one point was well over $3 million. And I'm talking years ago. It's much less than that now, and they continue to whittle away at those opportunities that, again, give our kids extended learning time. I'm not talking about the time during the school day for the Raymond and the Huntington, but just those kind of fun after-school activities, homework assistance that we have at a number of our schools. Also, BayWib, Brockton Area Workforce Investment Board, lost a Connecting Activities grant, and they also work in partnership with us, you know, for opportunities for our kids for programs after school and in the summer. And Aldo, you mentioned the facilities also?
Yes, we'd received our state representatives were able to secure for us in the budget process about $150,000 to work on the cupola at 43 Crescent Street, the headquarters, is actually in the National Historic Register. So there was some money specifically put in the budget for buildings such as, you know, a historic building like that. When it went through the House and Senate, the Joint Committee, they cut it from 150 down to 100,000, but they were able to save it. So that 100,000 then now made its way to the governor, but the governor just cut that also. So we lost the extra 100,000 that was earmarked specifically for McKinney-Vento homeless transportation, and now the money to go into the repairs necessary on our cupola. The repairs are much more than that, but that would have been a start in the process to get there. So, but I'm waiting for the actual details to come from the Department of Ed of all the other cuts. As the superintendent said, we don't know if there's some smaller cuts to some of the grants that we utilize, you know, the kindergarten grants, the early childhood grants. Quite often they'll go through and they'll just take a little piece of those. And again, these 9C cuts, routinely every year, they talk about them. They look at the state revenues, and if the state revenues aren't meeting the forecast, that's when the governor has the ability to go in and say, you know, we've got to make these cuts, you know, midway through the year before it becomes too late. So that's where we stand.
Just, Aldo, do you have a guess at this point what the total amount cut will be, or a little premature for that?
A little premature. I know of this 200,000 for sure.
For sure.
What the superintendent just spoke of, I'm not sure of the amounts that are going to be. But until I get a detail of it, because when they release the report, it's aggregated across the entire state.
Yep.
So.
Anyone with Mr. D'Agostino?
Just to clarify for myself, these cuts, these will affect the current fiscal year budget?
Correct. Correct.
Yes, correct.
Yes.
Okay.
This so is taking back money we already had.
That's what
I thought. I spoke to Mr. Condon already and notified him that, you know, busing could be an issue, but we will see how we are going. Mid-year for us is in February, you know, although people think it's January 1st, it's not, and the school system is more like February. As more and more of our McKinney-Vento homeless students get placed, we no longer have to provide busing services. So we're watching that closely. As that gets reduced, we might be able to make it through without that 100,000. If not, we're gonna have to go back to the city council if we can't make it through the school year, since we've budgeted for that money. Application was filed back in September to receive those funds. And instead of the receipt, the superintendent and I received an email directly from the executive director of finance of the Department of Ed notifying us, because he knew how important that money was. He sent us a personal email telling us the money's been cut, so.
I don't think he responded to my email.
Yeah. Mark, by the end of your next term, we're going to have you out of the Republican Party. I guess I'm going to say that's it.
It's a resurgence. I don't know.
Anyone else with a question or a comment for Mr. Petronio?
Okay. We'll keep you updated, as I said, when we have more exact amounts.
Thank you, Aldo.
And the last one is I'm going to ask Deputy Superintendent Thomas to come up and our facility director, Ken Thompson. We've had, you know that there is a program out there statewide. I think when you saw what happened in Flint, Michigan, our state took the step of making sure they were looking at all kinds of water usage in our schools, testing for different chemicals, or certainly lead and copper. We'll talk about that tonight. So as we start to get results, we do have kind of a plan in place, but I want you to hear exactly how we're dealing with this. And Deputy Superintendent Thomas, you want to start?
So results came back late yesterday afternoon for the Gilmore. They were 76 samples total taken from the Gilmore school. And six samples came back with elevated lead levels, and one sample came back with elevated lead and copper levels. These are from the fixtures. So it's the interior of the building. Fixtures, nothing to do with the water source coming in to the building. So immediately the remedy is to shut those sources off and then replace either the fixtures, or if they're not used, then you would eliminate them and cap them off altogether. And then there's protocols that the Department of Public Health put out for us to notify, you know, parents and the community. This has been going on throughout the whole state. You know, we want to thank, first it was the state offered this. We joined right away because we thought it was important to have all our schools tested. They took over 2,400 water samples, and I want to thank the facilities department, public property, the mayor's office, DPW. They all took part in helping us get these samples. It was a long process to make sure all the samples were taken correctly. Ken, can you explain just how the samples had to be done?
What we did, each fixture had two samples taken. The protocol was the first sample was taken 6 hours after the last water usage, so the building had to be dormant for 6 hours. They took that first sample. Then 30 seconds later, they take what they call a flush sample. The reason for the two samples, the first sample is indicative of the fixture and whatever piece of small piping is connected to the fixture. The second sample is the system-wide. So by getting our results in those two categories, we can determine whether it's the fixture itself or the water source coming into and generating through the building. So the good news, if there's any good news, was all of the high levels were within the fixture itself, not the water system in the building. So we're able to, we got the notification about 3:30 yesterday afternoon, and by 10 that evening, we had all of the fixtures taken apart, capped off, and secured, so there'd be no access with students, staff, or anybody else. And that process will be with each and every school as we go forward, depending on the results.
So basically, the results will come in just like they came in yesterday. It could take all the way to the end of January to get all 23 buildings done. I mean, for the results to come back, the state lab is pretty backed up because, again, they're doing this throughout the whole state. And, you know, they'll keep notifying us. We'll keep notifying you as the results come in. And the superintendent, you can speak about. You spent some time today with the mayor, you know, talk about how to.
We talked about obviously wanting to let our staff know, certainly letting our parents know. So a letter is going home tomorrow to the parents. We're also informing them that on our website, we will have a so-called bubble on the website that will talk about the water testing. So as the schools come in, parents and community members can go on board and see what the results are, you know, what the remedies are. So again, staff has been notified, parents will be notified. We have a statement, but we the mayor and I both spoke, and in the end, I think it's worthy of, you know, having our team come back and do a full report for the community and for the school committee rather than just piecemeal. I mean, as it's coming in, we'll, you know, be very transparent, have it out there. We're actually pleased, as you said, with these results. This was not the water. These were the fixtures. And interesting enough, when you talk about a school that opened up in 1965, I think, the Gilmore, the sinks had, I still say bubblers, you know, coming off of the sink. So you have the sink source, and you also have the you know, the kids don't use it for the bubblers anyway. We have the filtration systems throughout our district. So that's the good news. That's not used for drinking water at all. So to cap them off, you know, is really not an issue in the schools.
Yes, I mean, I think it's important for people to know, first of all, that how extensive this testing is that's being done, almost 2,500 samples taken from these 23 buildings. It was about a 6 to 8 week period to collect all of these samples, so it's probably going to be a 6 to 8 week period of us continuing to receive a steady stream of data as the results come back. And this was a statewide grant program with DEP. We were one of the first to take advantage of it, but a lot of communities are testing. And so the lab has got a little bit of turnaround time in order to get the results back. So certainly, the safety of our students and our staff is our primary concern. That's why we're doing the testing. So as any results come back that indicate any hits or hot spots where a sample does not fall within acceptable limits, they'll be being addressed immediately, just as they were at the Gilmore last night. And the data will be posted on the website and at each particular school. If we do take any corrective action at a particular school, the parents and the staff will be notified immediately as to what the results were and what is the corrective action that we're taking to remedy it. We feel very confident in the quality of the water supply in Brockton. We've got a great water supply here. So between Silver Lake and the Avon Reservoir and Aquaria, we feel very good about our water supply, keeping in mind that the city constantly tests the drinking water at various points all around the city as required by DEP. So we are constantly testing the quality of the drinking water. However, you know, most of these schools are not new, and just like many other communities, we may have some old plumbing in places that could be problematic in terms of lead or copper levels being above an acceptable level. And that's why we've entered into this very aggressive testing program to see what's there, and wherever we have any spots, we will address them as immediately and as effectively as we can. And as we get the results school by school, they will be posted on the website. Any corrective action will be notified immediately to families and staff. And then once we get all of the data in, you know, then we'll prepare for the school committee and the public a kind of a comprehensive summary of what the overall results were. So in this particular case, it was only about 10% of the samples at this school, stuff that was pretty easily remedied by just simply capping off those fixtures, and they're not fixtures that we need to use. And the results are going to vary, but as we've kind of taken a look online at other communities, every community is having some spots, and it really doesn't seem to matter whether it's city, suburb, affluent, not affluent. You know, everybody's got infrastructure, and there are going to be places where the water may be being impacted. One of the reasons we immediately applied for this program is lead levels in our children is a high concern here in the city of Brockton. We have one of the highest lead poisoning rates for children in the state. I believe we're third highest. We've been very aggressively chasing federal grant money through HUD for lead paint abatement. So it is a concern in a city like Brockton, and we just want to make sure that if there is any role in water in schools, that we're identifying and addressing it immediately. And that's what's going on. So I'm also very thankful for the cooperation for the city and school side, working very cooperatively and working with the DEP and getting these over 2,400 samples taken and into the lab. And as the results come back, we'll share them with everybody, and we'll very aggressively address any issues that arise. Any questions or comments from the committee? Ms. Plant.
I want to thank you, because I know that you were very proactive about this. You signed up for this program as soon as it was available, and we already had the filtration systems going in before that, before we received the results anyway. Yeah. So I want to thank you, because I know this was a concern that you wanted addressed before we even knew if we had a problem. You were already looking to make sure that our drinking water was safe in all of our schools.
Thank you.
And you've acted really quickly as well once we did get the results, so thank you for that. Are they going to be coming back after we get all the results and then after you make the necessary changes, retesting?
I don't know if that's part of the
program. We'll report the whatever remedies we took, whatever work, and I think they will. We do the testing, the sampling ourselves, and they will test, and I think they will retest.
Okay. Thank you.
We actually did the labor was performed by school and city personnel, the collecting of the samples. What the state grant did was pay for the lab work, which would have been very expensive for 2,400 samples. So it really is a cooperative effort, both local and state.
Do you think they would pay if we were to retest it after we make the changes?
I don't know the answer to that.
Yeah, they haven't said that yet. I don't think they've committed to that part yet, but you know, that's something we can look into. Ken has spent a lot of time.
In this particular case, let's see what the resolutions look like. Because in this particular case at the Gilmore, there'll be nothing to retest because the fixtures where there was issues have been disconnected and capped off. So there's no more water coming out.
And they haven't been using those for a drinking source because they use the filtration systems, which we've installed in the hallways, and so they really haven't been using the ones that are in. It's mostly they use the faucets for washing their hands. Another remedy, they'll, if they find, because they do test the sinks in the bathrooms, and if they do find high levels there, they either put you on a flushing program or you change the fixtures, and you also should hang up a sign saying for hand washing only, not consumption. So that's something that's another remedy that they ask you to do, so you know you're not drinking the water out of the sink in the bathroom. So And young kids, you know, you have to obviously point that out sometimes, so, because I used to do it as a kid. So.
It's like keeping the dog away from the toilet.
Exactly. So I we'll find out more about some retesting as we get further into the, you know, as more results come back.
Yeah, I mean, I think that, you know, let's get the results over the next 6 to 8 weeks. Let's make the necessary remedies. And then I think once all the data is back, we'll be able to summarize it for the committee and, you know, look at it together and decide if we think there are further steps we should take going forward. But this is just the first school of 23, so we're going to have this data coming in for the next couple months. Mr. D'Agostino.
Just curious. Obviously, we're doing the water testing. You mentioned that you're applying for grant funding to address lead paint issues. Mm-hmm. Being that we're the third highest instance of lead poisoning in children in the state, have we nailed down a source at all? Or are we just kind of looking at everything? And
it's, well, when you read these reports, it's, you know, typically older cities, older housing stock and poverty seem to be usually the biggest contributing factors. We also test for it much better than we used to also. Every pediatrician tests, you know, every kid gets blood tests and gets their lead levels checked. So, but it seems as though if there are common denominators among communities that have the higher lead levels, it's usually poverty and old housing stock.
Thanks.
And in the Friday packet, the DEP has some great frequently asked questions, and it talks about lead in the water and how do you, and you know, there's some great information here, and I'll put that in your Friday packet. So just in case you get any questions, there's some really good information in here to help you answer those.
Yep. Okay, any other questions or comments from the committee? Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Okay, I'll try to finish this up. I mentioned the holiday concert at Brockton High, and there are concerts going on throughout the city. I had the opportunity today to go to the George School, and interesting enough, the invited guest, the guest of honor, was Manthala George, the former superintendent, and Mr. Luisi, our former deputy superintendent, who, it is interesting when you hear the George School, I mean, he's sitting there, and I asked him how that felt, and it was wonderful. He addressed the parents, talked about what a great community it was, you know, the parent involvement, and why Brockton is so successful. So again, you know, these concerts are going on throughout the city. You might have had opportunities to go to some of your schools, but it is just amazing, this music program. It's amazing, the talent from our littlest kids today. I was watching them with their little, I'm trying to think what they're called.
Recorders?
Exactly, the little recorder group. And I could understand the tune, it was wonderful. So there's just so much going on, even to look at the band at the George today. You know, looking at them, you know, now being able to play together. So I just want to thank everybody. It's just a great season for everybody. Thank the parents who came out in droves, and I know this is going on throughout the city. Also, you know, I have here, and I'll put it in your Friday packet, and it's not complete, a couple of stories. I actually got a letter from a parent who had been a homeless family, found themselves homeless, and she took it upon herself to write me a very lengthy email. And it was talking about a teacher. It happened to be at the Angelo School, and it was one of our teachers, Dana Cohen, who has been a longtime member of our staff. And Dana represents so much of what's out there. And it talked about this teacher going above and beyond to make sure this child from the first day of school had supplies that he needed for school and made sure that the family could take part in events and in an unassuming way. And just made sure that the child was able to be part of the classroom and not be affected as much by the homelessness. The family has been relocated outside of Brockton, and this parent wanted me to know that this is what goes on, you know, in our district and what a difference it made. And I bring that up because I will put this in your Friday packet. Every school has so many things going on, from giving of hats and mittens at the Raymond School. I was there the other day. I think Mr. Henningsen had gotten a group together and got that. To all kinds of donations and kids doing great things. I heard the story of the Christmas tree at the high school, of the Giving Tree. and the kids, the teachers, were taking the tags, and I'm told there were 7 tags left, and a student came up and had worked and had some extra money and took the remaining 7 tags to make sure she could buy probably well over $200 worth of gifts, you know, giving to somebody else. Last night, Mayor, I went to the, is it called the Mayor's Holiday?
Well, it's a partnership. It's really a program started by the Brockton Public Schools 6 or 7 years ago that we partner with now, and it's through our adjustment counselors inviting families in need, students of families in need, for a Christmas dinner and Christmas gifts. And we had about 500 people at the Shaw Center last night, including about 300 students. And there was entertainment, there was music, there was
face painting, all kinds
of things, face painting, balloon animals,
yeah.
a beautiful turkey Christmas dinner. And then every child got to go into a great big room that was all full of brand new toys, right, and pick out a new toy to bring home. And we had everything from toddlers to teenagers. And it was really a cool event. And it's so many people helped us and sponsored it, and starting with the guidance department of the Brockton Public Schools. And we're very happy to partner on it. And that's where a lot of the toys from the Mayor's Toy Drive go. And it was a great event.
Yeah, packed, absolutely packed with people last night. And you could just, the look on the kids' faces, it was very exciting to to know that you made somebody's holiday very special. So again, I want to thank everybody in the Brockton community, the Brockton Public Schools, for doing what needs to be done during this holiday season. And I want to finish up with just mentioning about the planetarium, and I'm doing this for a reason. We know that on January 3rd, 2017, we will be opening the planetarium with many invited guests, but it only seats so many. And we have people that were science teachers here back when you think of 1970, 1971, opening up this high school, that have been waiting for this planetarium to open again. So we will be doing more than this one event. So we'll certainly get through the opening, the dedication. Thank you to everybody with the grant writing. Really staying the course on this so that the community can enjoy the planetarium, which for so many years, so many of our kids enjoyed. So there will be another invitation. And I told you that I would finish up with something special. So you did hear me speak about the Brockton team who joined with a couple of others at our event at the CASE conference, which is all of your Title I directors and programs. And we sat there that evening. I really let my hair down. I had a lot of fun this evening, finally. And we had such a great team and great competition that I thought I'd end tonight with some Christmas trivia, holiday trivia for all of you. So I want to test your knowledge now. So is everybody awake? Okay. So the first, and I'll go through them very quickly so everyone can leave. Number one, the name of Scrooge's dead business partner. Ooh. Wanda, are you keeping track here? That's right. Okay, who tried to steal Christmas from the Who's of Whoville?
Grinch. Oh, we all know that one.
Wow. What Christmas food is made from marsh horts?
Warts.
W-H-O-R-T-S, marsh, W-H-O-R-T-S. What Christmas food is made from that?
Did you know this?
No. No?
Yeah.
Do you think it's stuffing? Do you think it's sweet potatoes? Do you think it's marshmallows? Or do you think it's cranberry sauce? Cranberry sauce. Cranberry sauce. Okay, another tough one. What ocean is Christmas Island in?
Christmas Island.
Christmas Island. What ocean?
Pacific.
You've got 3 to go.
Okay.
Okay, it's not the Pacific. It's not the Atlantic. It's in the Indian.
Well, I was going to say Indian.
Okay, now these are easy. We'll finish up with some tunes. So here's your Christmas tunes. When you hear the phrase, tell me what song it is. Round yon virgin mother and child. Oh, Mr. Gormley, good job. Bearing gifts, we traverse afar. Good, Judy. I expected you get that.
Yeah, the CCD teacher is going to get these, yeah.
I'm going to break into song here. And heaven and nature sing. And heaven and nature sing.
Oh my God, I know the song.
Da, 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 da. Good job. Okay, tis the season to be jolly. Very good, good job. Last two. Joyful and triumphant. Good job. And the last one, O tidings of comfort and joy. O tidings of comfort and joy. Comfort and joy. Ooh. Is it Away in a Manger? Is it Ding Dong Merrily on High? Is it the First Noel? Or is it God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen? Is it? Good job.
I think Lisa won.
I think so too.
Yeah.
Mr. Minicello was there. I just want to also remind you that tomorrow, and Mr. Minicello, I know you're going to give me a hard time about this, is the superintendent's ice cream party. So this is my treat for everybody at Central. It is Peaceful Meadows with all of the fixings. It is from 1 to 3. It'll be held in the Nissel Conference Room, and I invite you to come in. It really is delicious. Yeah. So, Mr. Minicello, you want to say the first year got there late?
Yeah. Aldo's going to be there at 12:30.
1 to 3. So, Mayor, that is all I have for tonight.
That's it?
That's it.
Okay. Anyone else on a new business? Okay. How about a motion? Oh, you still have a new business? Okay.
Attended the Brockton Symphony over at West Middle School.
Yeah.
The South Middle School Choir accompanied the symphony for a few songs, and they were just outstanding. They were very well behaved, and they just did a great job. So my compliments to the students, and certainly their choir director, who did a wonderful job with them. As the superintendent mentioned, there was a great, you know, holiday concert. I did go both nights. I was thinking of just going one night, but it was so good, I went the second night. And we had some family come in from Bourne and Falmouth and Billerica and Hingham, and they were all so impressed with the performance. They've seen some other school districts, you know, do their performances, but they were really blown away with the Brockton combination of the band as well as the choirs. And
don't get me going, Mr. Gormley, now.
But I mean, our band is outstanding. Both the advanced band as well as the first tier with Mr. Cardell, the concert band. But our choirs are incredible as well. I mean, the music, the voices are just so strong and so pleasant to hear. So my compliments to both, you know, the students in the band and the choir. And then I was at a couple of schools, and I'd like to compliment the staff, both guidance people and teachers. You know, people don't know that there are collections going on in the schools of the staff to provide children that they identify that may not have for Christmas. And you know, they're raising their own money, and they're, you know, purchasing, you know, gift cards and presence, and it's a lot of kids that they are out of their own pockets providing, you know, something so that when these students go home on Friday, you know, they'll have a smile on their face that they're getting something. So we really have a very caring community here in Brockton, the public, but our staff is incredible as well, and I just want to compliment them on their generosity and their basically love of kids, you know. So.
Well said. Anyone else send a new business? I'll take a motion. We're 6 minutes over here. Motion's made and properly seconded to adjourn. All in favor?
Meeting adjourned.
Thank you
very much. Happy holidays. Merry Christmas.